Hi, my name is Dave Smith, and today we're talking about Grandpa and his famous cookie jar of medications. So we remember Grandpa. He's back because Grandma got hit by a reindeer and he's left to his own devices, managing his own medications. But today we're going to focus more about polypharmacy and how we don't want Grandpa to be taking that many medications and really be able to talk about why taking a lot of medications is especially dangerous for this Grandpa and probably yours. So we talked about Grandpa, 82-year-old with several diseases, chronic conditions in his past medical history, and a long medication list that we've already looked at for adverse drug reactions. So polypharmacy, there are a lot of different understandings about what polypharmacy is. Some definitions have it as just more than five medications. Other times it's more than one drug for a given indication. I think Steinman actually had a very nice definition that it's really this balance of unnecessary medications compared to providing beneficial therapy for every medication, but not more. So in that sense, how bad is polypharmacy in the US? Well, just recently in JAMA, in November of 2015, they looked at almost 40,000 patients, and they actually did a survey. So it's talking to patients rather than just looking at claims data. And they found that in the last 12 years, polypharmacy, which was taking more than five medications, rose from 24 to 39%, which was vastly more than 15% you'd see for some of your younger counterparts. So why does this happen? So there are two main buckets. There's a patient factor bucket. So you have increased chronic conditions, which makes complex drug treatment programs, and also psychosocial issues like self-medication that might be contributing. At the same time, systemic factors are underneath all of this, where you can have multiple prescribers sending it to multiple pharmacies, which creates something called a prescribing cascade. Now, this prescribing cascade you may or may not be familiar with, but it's probably more common than you think. This is the idea where a prescriber would prescribe drug one, and you might have an adverse drug reaction, except it's misinterpreted as a new medical condition. And then you have drug two leading to more adverse drug effects. An example of this might be a patient with mild dementia is started on donepezil. One of the adverse drug side effects of donepezil might be urinary incontinence. Then they're prescribed oxybutynin, which is used to treat that and is anticholinergic, like we saw from the first two modules, causing delirium. But it could also simply be that this patient has worsening Alzheimer's dementia, leading to unstable aggressive episodes. So it's very important to get a good medical or medication history for these patients. And I also refer you to table 9 in the syllabus, simply for better and more common examples that you can see. So why do we care so much about polypharmacy? We obviously saw that increases non-adherence, leads to more adverse drug events and drug interactions. I think we've covered those in the first several modules. With regards to admissions, it's particularly important because adverse drug events, if you have 6 admissions, one and maybe a little bit more is actually going to be due to an adverse drug reaction, which is directly linked to polypharmacy. So it's something we want to avoid as much as possible. And even more so, that mortality, that hazard ratio is actually increased every time you start taking more than 5 medications in your patients. So let's bring this back to Grandpa. So we looked at his med list before and tried to identify adverse drug reactions. So let's take a look at it again and find out how can we actually simplify and pare down these medications. So remember, we talked about aspirin and warfarin potentially leading to increased bleeding. But you should also ask yourself, if you take it to the next level, why is he even taking aspirin if he's also on warfarin? So you should actually assess Grandpa to find out there's a clear indication for aspirin, since it's obviously adding to a potential dangerous situation. He's also on omeprazole, but if you look on his past medication history, I don't see any acid reflux, peptic ulcer disease. So you should assess whether or not he actually needs that. And metformin is a diabetic drug. I don't see diabetes on this past medical history. Now, it may be there, but if it's not listed, it's probably incumbent upon you to go and make sure that this actually has to be there. So what are the take-home points for this? One, keeping the med list short is absolutely key. You need to make sure you know every single indication is still there for every single medication, and keep it sweet. When I say keep it sweet, make it as simple as possible. So once daily drugs, if you gave these to Grandpa and you prescribed the perfect drug for him, he would only take it 4 out of every 5 days. Now, if you change that and made it a 4 times a day drug medication, that adherence drops to 50%. So the best laid plans will never be seen if you're not prescribing simple drugs. So that leads to probably the second major tenet when prescribing to elderly, which is start low and go slow. We touched upon this a little bit in the pharmacokinetic discussion in module 1, but it really makes sense that there's very little rush to get to therapeutic doses when you're not sure how quickly your grandpa may actually get there. So what are the take-home points with regards to polypharmacy and grandpa? First, keep the med list short. When you're prescribing, start low, go slow, and make sure you know every indication for every med every single time you see your patients. Thank you.